Okay, so on to restricting mobility. So this section, Tryon is talking about the historical relationship between streaming and movie studios and television networks. So again, we've seen this before with Netflix, but the producers of television and film content, which is, you know, again, this kind of interesting sort of alliance between the two, because they're kind of, you know, coming together, positioned, yeah, let's say against sort of the streaming, like what have become the streaming giants. And also we're thinking about Hulu's initial establishment, and you know, Hulu is probably, you know, it's certainly at one point the biggest kind of competitor to Netflix, but certainly one of the sort of major streaming platforms at this point. And it is important to note, right, that as Tryon points out, that the television industry, that certain television channels actually have ownership, or had, and I think do have ownership stake in Hulu to this day. So it's like, it's not quite entirely right that all the television industry, or all of the industry, was necessarily, you know, like kind of situated or positioned against Hulu, but actually, or in streaming at large, right? And Tryon points out that Hulu's initial kind of success was in, you know, establishing themselves as a sort of place for flexible viewing, right? Which you know, and we'll, I guess we'll get to this in a second, but really does have a kind of historical relationship with flexible and also precarious labor, right? You know, meaning that the kind of history of network television is so closely tied to a kind of certain type of sort of working day, right, and a certain pattern of life. But now, you know, with, I mean, even like, you know, like, I'm gonna be totally frank, it's like, it's 1:15 right now. This is not the normal time that we generally meet for class and do class, so, and to be fair, like, that's not to say that, you know, I think, like, this is very flexible work, but not nearly as precarious as other forms. But, you know, even with you all, right, like, you're going to be consuming this, that's a weird way of putting it, you're going to be watching this and sort of thinking about this in your own patterns, but this is all to say that, you know, the character of work has changed drastically, immensely, you know, in the last kind of 30 years or so, or even further, depending on who you ask. And so it's really much more difficult, for numerous reasons that I think people like Tryon are actually talking about, to kind of get that sort of historical, or perhaps, you know, even that would probably be, I'm trying to be really careful, especially because this stuff is now all on video, I can't just say whatever I want like I usually do. But let's say, like, the imagined kind of idea of a family all gathering around a television at 8 o'clock prime time on a Thursday night, right? That's just no longer nearly as possible as we might have once thought, and so a lot of people are catching this stuff. But that's the trick, right? It's like, there's still that kind of, you still want to be a part of the conversation. You want to be able to talk about what happened on the show last night. That's still that kind of, you know, the kind of so-called water cooler culture is still evident. And so even though we might not be seeing it at time of, you know, air, but there's still this sort of impetus or imperative to watch it as quickly as possible, when possible, right? And that's where Hulu kind of really cornered the market, right? Is that, like, we'll air it pretty soon, not like, you know, like simultaneously, right? However, even that, right? Tryon points out Fox's, how they implemented the authentication system, right? And this becomes a huge thing, right? That in and of itself becomes this sort of issue of restriction and access, right? This sort of back and forth or dialectical relationship between, you know, here, you can have some? No. That's like basically what's going on here, right? So, you know, I mean, think about the fact that, like, early on in Netflix, you know, people were kind of sharing accounts and passing passing their passwords around. I think in my case, I was sharing with, like, maybe one person. And then at some point, they just implemented, you know, those stupid smiley faces where it's like, ooh, you know. Where it's like, in my case, it's like, say young, not say young, you know, and then like my aunt, right? You know, but so it's like they know that that was going on, and they figured that it was just probably better to let users share accounts instead of, like, you know, really coming down on it, which they could have, right? Which begs the question, you know, someone like Trial would ask, like, yes, they're allowing this, but what aren't they allowing? Well, for one, they're not allowing me to share this with infinite viewers, right? At some point, it needs to come to a stop, and so there is, like, a limit to how much sharing is possible, right? And so authentication systems, and we'll see this later when he talks about ultraviolet, right? Like, just like, it's like, you gotta go through one door, you gotta go through another door. It's like, I don't remember all my passwords. You know, like, they have different password rules, like, where it's like, this one needs special characters, this one needs, like, you know, uppercase, and this one needs lowercase. It's like, I you know, like, who has time for all of that, right? But anyways, those can, and those do, become bars to entry, right? And the key thing, right, is that, like, so in this case, so it's like, if you need a Fox authentication system, you need a Hulu authentication system, but then you need another one that's like for NBC, let's say. So you have made three different accounts, you know, that's three different user agreements, that's three different entities that you are providing more data for, right? So it's not only that it's a bar to access of entry, but it's also an access point for the corporate entity, right? Okay, so this is also in this section, Trion is talking about, I'm gonna leave that up, I kinda like that. How this is ultimately, so when we talk about the process of negotiation, it's the ongoing negotiation between consumers and producers about what? About value. And the value of what? Of media content. And we see this, we'll see this on Thursday, right? Right, as if you guys know off the top of your head. But this is something that's changing immensely, especially in the sort of digital shift, you know. This is something that becomes a real kind of sticking point, for example, with the music industry, right? But just with digital media in general. And this idea of, like, trying to find, it's always fascinating, right? When I know some prominent musicians have done this, where it's like, we'll upload the thing, you pay what you want, right? And it's always kind of fascinating that people do, you know, generally for the most part, will pay in a way that we will read as being reasonable. Like, very few people will be like, I'm not paying anything then. And on the other hand, no one is going to be like, I'm gonna give you $10,000. It's like, generally it's going to be some kind of number that sort of correlates to what the kind of perceived value is. But having said that, there's still kind of this process, right, of trying to figure out, like, you know, how much am I willing to charge as a producer? How much is the consumer willing to pay, right? This is all kind of part of what's going on, right? And they talk about all of that on 42. So let's move on to kind of what is a big chunk of the reading is the defunct service Ultraviolet. I had to think really hard about this because it's something that I barely remember, and then I did remember that there were some Blu-rays and DVDs that I bought that had this that offered this, and I think I never went through the trouble of actually, or maybe I think I did. I think I did once. So I might have an Ultraviolet account somewhere. I guess I could look it up, but I'm not going to. So think about this. This is kind of crazy if you think about it. This was created by film studios, right? A service created by film studios, which called themselves the Digital Entertainment Content Ecosystem, right? The DECE, except, right, Disney and Apple. So you have the big six. For film studios. Disney is the only one that opts out. Apple also opts out, and this creates huge problems. Why? Now, for one, I mean, this is like, you know, it's like the Avengers on some level, right? It's like Netflix and Hulu are Thanos, right? It's like, let's see if I can do this. Yeah, that's a pretty good Thanos. And the studios are like, this is a big enough problem that we need to pool our resources and do something together. They're competitors, and yet this is the bigger threat, so they come together, right? But Disney and Apple aren't really threatened enough, and or they have, you know, their own plans. And Disney, we know, eventually that would become Disney Plus. Apple, you know, as becomes evident in this week, you know, iTunes is more than enough for them, that like they're not really threatened by Netflix. Netflix and Thanos, Netflix and Hulu, right? And so not having Apple became a huge problem, right, for the DECE, right? Why? Because for the most part, it's like at least half of the electronics market, right, between like iOS devices, and then you have your Android devices. So you need Apple to provide direct access to the hardware to get DECE and ultraviolet content onto. So whether it's iPads, iPhones, and Macs, right? Especially if you think about the tablet market and basically how iPad dominates that, more certainly, probably more than phones, you know, you're losing direct access to a good chunk, right, of consumers. Now, that doesn't mean you can't get the content on there, right? But it's just you have to go through third party. It's another extra step. And as we know, extra steps are partially what all of this is about, right? Like we've seen time and time again how convenience factors into all of this, right? And again, this sort of relationship between like what is an iPad, a MacBook, an iPhone, really, it's direct access and it's a delivery system. It's not really about how great this or this is, it's that this gives Apple direct access to put content, you know, in your pocket or in your house. It's like a direct route, right? This idea of like routes, infrastructure, right, supply chains, this will come back again on Thursday, right? But other notable, right, Comcast was part of the DECE. You know, again, internet provider, but also content producer, right? Nokia, don't laugh, you know, at one point they were a major player. Again, this is, you know, all of this stuff is so volatile that a major producer like Nokia is now relegated to a joke, right, to a meme. But again, cell phone provider, right? And then Microsoft, same thing, you know. There's a reason why Bill Gates is a billionaire, right? It's because as much as Macs and MacBooks are kind of favored amongst particular, you know, kind of consumers, for the most part, like PCs dominate worldwide, right? So, and yet, like, you know, the fact that it's interesting, right? It's like most computers around the world are PCs. This one is not. And yet, even having Microsoft as part of the Avengers just wasn't enough. Like, not having Apple was that big of a problem, right? Okay. So, let's kind of clear the board a little bit. Just sort of leave ultraviolet and DECE. This is an effort, right? So there's the transition in home media, right? We're moving away from, let's say, cable and DVDs and into the era of streaming, And this is a collective effort by the industry to kind of revive, right, this sort of culture of buying and collecting. Now, a lot of people, especially kind of people that are more open to technology or kind of technical or like technological culture, you know, a lot of people like, you know, are okay with sort of digital collections, digital collecting, right? But there's still a lot of people that, you know, I don't think as much anymore. I think we've already kind of made the shift, but that sort of, you know, kind of practice of just sort of like buying and having a collection, like curating a collection, right? That's what they were trying to do, right? But with streaming, right? So it's like you can have your physical your discs, but also you can have the kind of films. It's like it's no longer a file, right? It's a film, but just like a digital film, right? And more importantly, right, it's like, is the DEC, is Nokia and Microsoft, right, and the other studios, are they really kind of like romantically invested in a collector culture? It's like, no, it's they're trying to capitalize on a volatile market, right? Things are changing quickly. Things have not stabilized. Things have not calcified. There's no real direction. So this is where we can make money, right? We know for a fact, right, that there are people that are horribly like looking right now to try and make money off of the kind of state of things. There's that famous story. I guess I won't throw that guy under the bus, but we, you know, like, you know, and it just kind of like, it's kind of gross, right? But it's not dissimilar, really. It's like when there's volatility, when there's instability, there's also kind of the sort of moment for exploitation, for capitalization, right? And that's what they're trying to do. It's not because they care so much about, you know, my DVD collection, right? And that I can do that online as well. So again, what is this really about? It's about distribution, right? And it's specifically about kind of bypassing the middleman. So trying to go around, not rely on Netflix, not rely on Hulu, or not rely on iTunes, but to try and get digital distribution directly from producers to the consumer, right? And more importantly, it's also about controlling consumption, right? So on 44, let's see, where on 44? This is at the very bottom, right? However, Ultraviolet also fight, Ultraviolet. Ultraviolet was a film by, what was his name? Kurt, the guy who did Equilibrium. Anyways, doesn't matter. Ultraviolet also functioned as a form of controlled consumption, shaping when and where users could be would be able to access their collections while also swaddling users' contents in digital rights management software, DRM, that would prevent them from copying their movies or sharing them with others, a technique that was policed in part by demanding that users submit multiple logins in order to consume movies that they already own. So it's getting the stuff in our hands, but it's also having all sorts of DRM software which prohibits, you know, kind of unlimited sharing or copying. So it's like it's yours, but they're still kind of controlling what and how you're able, you know, to access and what you're able to do with it, right? So it's, again, it's like both of these things at the same time. It's yours, but not really. And we've seen this time and time again with digital media, right? And yet, at the same time, it's right, it's like there's still a middleman, right? And we see this with the deal with Walmart and Vudu, right? And again, very similarly, like this weird kind of thing about like, here you can own something you already know, like that the thing that he talks about on 45, where that you could bring your DVD collection to Walmart, and they would digitize it for you, for a cost though, right? And then it's like the $2 for normal, you know, digitization, $5 for kind of high def, right? Finally, in relation to all of this, I do want to bring up like cloud computing, right, and cloud storage, right? Another thing that we generally don't think about too much, but also kind of take for granted, and also in terms of thinking about digital utopia, you know, for example, it's so easy for me to do all this right now because of cloud storage, right? Whether it's through Google, whether it's through Apple, especially Dropbox, right, which Apple tried to buy a long, long time ago. Again, cloud computing is great, but for Tryon, cloud computing is also something that's related to all of this, right? In the sense that, for one, like people don't know too much about it, and two, you know, is it nearly as great as it's kind of made out to be? And so on 46, there's a great kind of page, or passage, half page, when he's talking about, and he brings up Wheeler Winston Dixon, another media scholar. And so about halfway down, in terms of they're talking about, Netflix had bought Stars, and so they had STA or Z. And so they had the rights to Sony content. Sony basically asked them to take it down. As this example shows, competing forms of digital ownership may actually reduce points of access to movies and television shows. Dixon concludes that digital storage is by no means a guarantee of permanent access. So that's the thing, is the idea about cloud computing is that it's not susceptible to degradation in the way that like hard drives, you know, fail, right? Storage can, or files can get, data can get corrupted. Back up your media, by the way. You know, it's like, it's supposed to be endless, right? Cloud computing is that like you can, you know, upload as much as you want, but that doesn't mean that it's always going to be there, and that doesn't mean that you'll always have access to it, right? Dropbox could go under, right? And then what happens to your media? A better example is like I have a bunch of content on, like for example Yahoo, and then there are a number of Yahoo services from like 20 years ago that you know I've gotten notices in the last like few years where it's like we're taking this down, get your media, right? You know, I won't get into that too much, but it's like it wasn't there anymore. They didn't even have it anymore. Dixon concludes, or especially given that digital formats constantly need to be upgraded, right? So even the formats themselves, right? And we know this, right? Like media formats have changed immensely. Like I've been thinking quite a bit about like Real Media Player, and you don't see Real Media formats anymore, right? Upgraded, maintained, or transferred to new platforms, raising questions about how these costs will be subsidized and by whom, right? And so upkeep is expensive, you know. How do I put this? I guess the way to put it is just like, you know, what they're basically between Dixon and Tryon are suggesting is that, you know, this stuff costs money, and the chances are is that the consumer is going to have to pay for it, right? Okay, so we're nearing the end stretch.